During the early 1960s, air travel began to experience rapid growth in demand. The post-war economic boom had created a rising middle class, and airlines like Pan Am, TWA, and Boeing were expanding global networks. However, airports and aircraft were struggling to keep up with the increasing passenger volume. Boeing had introduced its first four-engine passenger jet, the 707, on December 20, 1957, followed by the Douglas DC-8 from rival manufacturer Douglas Aircraft. But neither was large enough to meet the surge in long-haul traffic. This growing pressure on capacity led Pan Am to push for something unprecedented, a much larger aircraft that could carry more passengers at lower cost. In 1965, during a fishing trip in Alaska, Juan Terry Trippe, president of Pan American World Airways, and Boeing CEO William McPherson Allen, casually discussed the vision of a superjet. What began as a conversation by the water soon sparked one of the most ambitious engineering projects in aviation history. Juan Trippe, one of Boeing's most influential customers, proposed a jet airliner 2.5 times the size of the Boeing 707. It would need to carry over 400 passengers, reduce the cost per passenger mile by 30%, and make international air travel truly accessible to the masses. He also believed a larger aircraft could ease growing airport congestion. The two men reached a verbal understanding, often called a gentleman's agreement, right there on the fishing trip. Trippe famously declared, "If you build it, I'll buy it," to which Allen replied, "If you buy it, I'll build it." After Boeing accepted the challenge, they knew it was a gamble, one that could bankrupt the company if it failed. But leading the charge was a man perfectly suited for the task, Joe Sutter, a brilliant and pragmatic engineer known for breaking conventions and thinking on a grand scale. Sutter assembled a small but elite team of just over 4,500 engineers who would come to be known as the Incredibles. Together, they were tasked with designing the largest, most ambitious commercial aircraft the world had ever seen. Boeing designated the new jet as the Model 747, continuing the company's 700 series naming convention for commercial airliners. In the earliest stages of design, engineers explored a number of radical configurations. One of the leading concepts was a double-deck fuselage, essentially stacking two narrow-body cabins atop each other. While promising in terms of capacity, it presented serious challenges: structural complexity, limited cargo flexibility, and most critically, safety concerns about evacuating hundreds of passengers from an upper deck in an emergency. As a result, Boeing pivoted toward a wide single-deck design, the world's first true wide-body airliner, with a spacious cabin capable of accommodating hundreds of passengers side by side. Yet, the most iconic feature of the 747 wasn't its width, but its distinctive upper deck hump. This wasn't aesthetic, it was practical. Boeing wanted the 747 to be easily convertible into a freighter, and that meant incorporating a swing-up nose cargo door. To keep the cockpit out of the way of cargo loading, engineers raised it above the main deck, creating a small upper-level cabin that would eventually be used for lounges or additional seating. This raised cockpit gave the 747 its unmistakable profile. Coupled with newly developed high-bypass turbofan engines from Pratt & Whitney, which delivered unprecedented thrust and fuel efficiency, the 747 was taking shape, not just as a superjet, but as a bold new vision of air travel. However, Boeing faced a major challenge, as none of Boeing's existing facilities were nearly large enough to build the enormous 747. So, the company launched a nationwide search, evaluating over 50 cities before settling on a site 30 miles north of Seattle, adjacent to Payne Field in Everett, Washington. In June 1966, Boeing purchased 780 acres of land, and what followed was one of the most ambitious industrial construction projects in aviation history. President William McPherson Allen appointed Malcolm Stamper, then head of Boeing's turbine division, to lead the effort. Over 4 million cubic yards of earth had to be removed just to level the site. Time was so short that engineers began constructing the full-scale mock-up of the aircraft before the roof of the factory had even been completed. The Everett plant would become the largest building by volume ever constructed, an engineering marvel in itself, built specifically to accommodate the Boeing 747's unprecedented size. And it had to be. The 747's fuselage measured over 225 feet in length and 27 feet in diameter, with a tail standing nearly 6 stories tall. No existing facility could support such massive components, so Boeing engineered entirely new infrastructure to handle them. This included state-of-the-art tooling, specialized transporters, and overhead crane systems capable of lifting and positioning multi-ton assemblies with precision. Gigantic jigs held the fuselage and wings in place during integration, while miles of wiring, hydraulics, and ductwork were installed by hand. The 747's double-deck layout, wide-body frame, and expansive wingspan of nearly 196 feet created complex challenges in structural integrity, cabin pressurization, and aerodynamics, all of which required new solutions and testing protocols. To keep pace with Pan Am's delivery schedule, Boeing had to implement a parallel workflow where engineering, tooling, and production progressed simultaneously. Despite the immense pressure, under Malcolm Stamper's determined leadership, the plant rose from a muddy hillside into a fully functioning production complex in record time. It became more than just a factory, it was the birthplace of a revolution in commercial aviation, purpose-built to bring the world's first true jumbo jet to life. On September 30, 1968, in front of a crowd of more than 26,000 guests at the Everett factory, Boeing rolled out the very first 747, an aircraft so massive and unlike anything that had come before it that many simply called it the jumbo jet. Draped in Boeing's red, white, and blue prototype livery, the aircraft instantly became a symbol of aviation's bold new future. The rollout wasn't just a media spectacle, it was a show of confidence to an airline industry waiting anxiously. By then, Boeing had secured orders from 26 airlines totaling over 150 aircraft, with Pan Am, Lufthansa, Japan Airlines, British Overseas Airways Corporation, and Air France among the earliest customers. Pan Am alone had ordered 25 aircraft, a massive vote of faith in an aircraft that, until then, had never flown. That changed on February 9, 1969, when the prototype 747, registered N7470, took to the skies for the first time. At the controls were Boeing's chief test pilot Jack Waddell, co-pilot Brian Weigel, and flight engineer Jess Wallach. The takeoff was smooth, almost anticlimactic for an aircraft of such size. The flight lasted 1 hour and 15 minutes, remaining within range of Payne Field in case of emergency. During the test, the crew evaluated the aircraft's basic handling characteristics, engine performance, and systems response. Despite minor issues, like a slight oscillation in the landing gear door and a few telemetry glitches, the flight was declared a success. The 747 had proven it could fly, and fly well. After the aircraft touched back down, a wave of applause erupted inside the control room at Payne Field, where Boeing's flight test engineers and executives had been monitoring every second. But they weren't the only ones celebrating. While access to the test was restricted, many Boeing employees, including engineers, technicians, and support staff, gathered along designated viewing areas near the runway and factory balconies to witness the historic moment. When the 747 landed safely, cheers and applause broke out from every corner. For those who had spent years working on the aircraft, it meant one thing: the 747 didn't merely fly, it exceeded expectations. With that first landing, the world's first jumbo jet had taken its first step toward revolutionizing air travel. On the night of January 21, 1970, history was made as Pan American World Airways prepared to operate the first ever commercial flight of the Boeing 747. The aircraft originally scheduled for the honor was Clipper Young America, the very jet that had been christened just days earlier by First Lady Pat Nixon at Washington Dulles Airport, in a ceremony marking the dawn of a new era in aviation. But just before departure from New York's JFK Airport, a mechanical issue grounded the plane. In its place, Clipper Victor was brought in, a backup 747 that had already been delivered to Pan Am. Though delayed by several hours, Flight 2 eventually lifted off after midnight, bound for London Heathrow. With more than 350 passengers aboard, it wasn't just the first jumbo jet flight, it was a revolution in global travel. Pan Am President Juan Trippe called it a great weapon for peace, and he was right. The 747 would make long-distance air travel faster, more affordable, and more accessible than ever before. When the plane touched down at Heathrow the next morning, it was greeted with applause, cameras, and a sense that the future of aviation had just arrived. Following the success of the original 747-100, Boeing quickly responded to airline demands for more capability. In 1971, it unveiled the 747-200, featuring more powerful engines, a higher maximum takeoff weight, and greater range, allowing it to fly farther without refueling. This variant became especially popular with international carriers like British Airways, Japan Airlines, and KLM, who needed reliable long-haul performance. But one request came from an even more niche segment, ultra-long-range flights from high-altitude airports. In response, Boeing developed the 747 SP, or Special Performance, a shorter, lighter version with extended range. The 747 SP had its first flight on July 4, 1975, and entered commercial service in 1976 with both Pan Am and Iran Air. The SP sacrificed seating capacity for range, enabling routes like New York to Tehran, one of the longest nonstops in the world at the time. These new variants underscored Boeing's commitment to refining the jumbo jet for a changing world, even as the aircraft faced some of its earliest challenges. Though the Boeing 747 was a triumph of engineering, it wasn't immune to tragedy. In 1971, Pan Am Flight 845 suffered a severe tail strike during takeoff in San Francisco due to last-minute runway changes and miscommunication, injuring several passengers. The aircraft sustained major damage but was later repaired and returned to service. Then in 1974, Lufthansa Flight 540 crashed shortly after takeoff from Nairobi, becoming the first fatal accident involving a 747, caused by a slat system malfunction that led to a stall, killing 59 people. But the most catastrophic incident came in 1977, at Los Rodeos Airport in Tenerife, Canary Islands. Amid dense fog, overcrowded taxiways, and fatal miscommunication, a KLM 747 began its takeoff roll without proper clearance, just as a Pan Am 747 was taxiing across the same runway. The KLM jet, accelerating at full power, collided at an angle with the Pan Am aircraft, its fuselage and engines tearing through the upper deck and igniting a massive fire. All 248 people on board the KLM flight were killed, along with 335 passengers and crew on the Pan Am flight. Yet 61 people survived, including the Pan Am pilots, who helped lead survivors to safety through a hole in the fuselage. In total, 583 lives were lost, making it the deadliest aviation accident in history. The tragedy led to sweeping changes in aviation, including standardized phraseology, enhanced cockpit communication, and stricter ground control protocols, reforms that have saved countless lives since. Despite the setbacks of its early years, the Boeing 747's legacy was far from over. On October 5, 1982, Boeing introduced the 747-300, featuring a stretched upper deck that increased passenger capacity, but it was only a stepping stone. The real leap forward came with the 747-400, which first took flight on April 29, 1988. It was more advanced, more efficient, and more capable than any of its predecessors. Outfitted with state-of-the-art glass cockpits, the 747-400 eliminated the need for a flight engineer. Its distinctive winglets reduced drag and improved fuel economy, giving it the range to cross oceans without refueling. It could fly over 7,000 nautical miles, reshaping global routes. The world's leading airlines quickly lined up: British Airways, KLM, Qantas, Lufthansa, Singapore Airlines, and Japan Airlines all made the 747-400 their flagship. Over 690 units were delivered, making it the most successful variant in the 747 family, and the backbone of long-haul fleets for more than two decades. But even this chapter had its own tragedy. On October 31, 2000, Singapore Airlines Flight 006, a 747-400, attempted to take off from a closed runway during heavy rain in Taipei. The aircraft collided with construction equipment, killing 83 of the 179 people on board. It was a rare blemish on an otherwise stellar safety record, a reminder that even the most advanced machines rely on human precision. Still, the 747-400 soared on, its silhouette becoming a symbol of aviation's golden era. But Boeing's reign didn't go unchallenged. In the early 2000s, its European rival, Airbus, unveiled an ambitious plan to build the largest passenger aircraft in the world, designed to dethrone the 747. The result was the Airbus A380, a full-length double-decker giant that could carry over 850 passengers in an all-economy configuration. Airbus believed the future still belonged to mega hubs and mass air travel, and the A380 would be the aircraft to rule that sky. But the world had already begun to change. While the A380 briefly stole headlines, its arrival signaled a turning point. The market wasn't asking for bigger planes, it was demanding more efficient ones. And though the A380 was a technological marvel, it couldn't outrun the changing economics of aviation. Ironically, in trying to compete with the 747, Airbus had inadvertently helped define the world that would render both giants obsolete. As the aviation world moved into the 21st century, the landscape was changing. airlines no longer prioritized sheer capacity. They wanted efficiency, flexibility, and lower operating costs. Twin-engine widebodies like the Boeing 777, the 787 Dreamliner, and the Airbus A350 began dominating long-haul routes, offering similar range with dramatically better fuel economy and easier maintenance. Yet Boeing wasn't ready to say goodbye to the 747 just yet. In 2011, the company introduced the 747-8 Intercontinental, the longest passenger aircraft ever built. It featured next-generation engines derived from the 787 Dreamliner, a redesigned, more efficient wing, and updated avionics. But despite these advances, the aviation world was already shifting toward more fuel-efficient, twin-engine aircraft. Only a few airlines placed orders for the passenger version. Lufthansa became the largest operator with 19 aircraft, while Korean Air acquired 10, and Air China took delivery of 7. Meanwhile, the freighter version, the 747-8F, saw greater success. Cargo giants like UPS ordered 28, Cargolux and Cathay Pacific Cargo each ordered 14, and Nippon Cargo Airlines added 8 to their fleet, drawn by the aircraft's exceptional range and payload capacity. Though no longer the face of global passenger travel, the 747-8 stands as a powerful final chapter in the jumbo jet legacy, carrying freight, and the spirit of the skies, into a new era. High fuel prices and the shifting economics of aviation made the 747 increasingly difficult to justify. One by one, airlines began to retire their fleets. British Airways, Qantas, KLM, and United all said their goodbyes, some with grand tributes, others during the quiet skies of a global pandemic. Today, only a few carriers still operate the 747 in passenger service, Lufthansa, Korean Air, and Air China among them. It was Pan Am that first introduced the world to the jumbo jet, a bold step into the future. And now, we're left to wonder, who will be the last to fly her? These are the final chapters of an icon. If you've ever dreamed of flying aboard a 747, now is the time. The Queen of the Skies may not rule forever, but her legacy is already immortal. If the Queen of the Skies left you in awe, don't forget to like this video, share your thoughts in the comments, and subscribe for more stories that change the world.